a lot of Indiana Jones, as opposed to visual effects, was really done with live-action set special effects, you know, explosions and that sort of thing. That demanded a lot of very good and creative stunt work and special effects in terms of live-action effects. And we were able to take the level of stunt work and move it to a higher level than we had seen before in these kinds of films.
Now we've gone through that, and now the rear car comes up and starts to try to jog him into position so he can get into a firing position. Right. Indy looks right.
I've made a number of movies that have required expertise that I don't have in choreographing stunts to keep it safe, to keep it honest, to keep it realistic. And I've been blessed working with some of the best stuntmen in the business. For Raiders, I had three of the greatest stuntmen in history working on this one movie. I had Glenn Randall.
Boom! Throws him through here, you miss. He comes right home. Boom!
And then I had Terry Leonard.
The only way I want you guys to grab me is if I get in trouble.
Yeah.
Because I can get a rhythm going here, and if I got to worry about grabbing you.
And then I had Vic Armstrong, who did most of Harrison's doubling because he looked so much like Harrison. The audience wouldn't know.
He has to physically pick her really hard. And then he whips these two guys back, and then she cracked over the horse once.
Stephen and George both have a vivid imagination for these things, and it often is left to the arranger to figure out how to make it work. And sometimes a little bit left over for me to wrestle
with. Okay, first move, boom, lock, boom, boom, in. No, that's the move. Okay, now when you...
Harrison is fantastic to work with. He's very tough. He's the biggest problem is he wants to do everything himself. You've got to keep holding him back because he's talented enough and physically fit enough to do it all, but he is the star of millions of dollars worth of movie and you can't risk anything happening to him.
I had total confidence in the stunt guys and they thought through what was safe and what was not, both for themselves and for me. So it was just another day at the office for me.
The opening sequence of Raiders was broken up so much into studio location. So the studio stuff, they'd basically done most of that with a guy, Dublin Harrison, called Martin Grace, a great friend of mine, stunt guy. I pick up the chase, if you like, in Hawaii, where the ball rolls and bursts out in the jungle, and I did the dive out in the jungle as the ball goes past and everything. So it's basically shot by shot by shot, just broken down, working closely with Kit West, special effects guy. But it was all very controlled, but again, it's the vision of Steven that made it look so real, so realistic.
So the next time we do it, I'm aiming for your head.
Right.
That's for sure.
Yeah.
I think every sort of element that one wants to get into a movie was captured in that movie, which made it tough. Consequently, years later, when you're trying to set up movies and arrange and coordinate sequences or event sequences in movies, people go, no, I can't do that. They did it in Raiders. It used to drive us mad. Everything was sort of thrown into it.
One of the original images that sent me off on this archaeologist looking for paranormal kinds of things was a shot that was repeated several times in several different Republic serials of a guy on a horse jumping onto a truck. So we did that stunt, that exact same stunt, and built a whole sequence off of it. And the stunt under the truck is, again, a kind of time-worn stunt from the action-adventure serials from the 30s, and it would happen a lot in old westerns. And Terry Leonard, who was one of the stunt guys, had just tried this stunt on the Legend of the Lone Ranger.
He said, there's a stunt that I tried to do that I was actually copying Yakima Canutt, the famous stunt in Stagecoach, where he went under all the horses and the covered wagon.
And in that particular situation, it didn't turn out too well.
The swing team got a little out of line and pulled me over under the wheelers, and one of the wheelers stepped on me, broke my handhold loose, and shot me out the passenger side of the coach. And the front wheel and the right rear wheel ran over the backside of my legs. Needless to say, if I had come out of there head first and been hit in the head by that one of those wheels, it would have been a little different story.
And Terry said, this has been eating away at me for years. Is there any way you can add a stunt where I go under the truck and come back out the other side? So that whole stunt was Terry Leonard's idea.
So I said, Glenn, you're driving the truck. I've got a lot of confidence in Glenn. I'd trust my life with him. And we didn't have room under the back, the third member, the gearbox, not literally the gearbox, but what they call the pumpkin on the back of that truck. If I laid under that truck, it hit me in the chin. So I had to get lower than that pumpkin. So they had a pick and shovel detail out there digging this trench so that thing would go right over my head. And I had clearance underneath the truck. A number of us that had our hand in the pie on Raiders, but I was lucky to get the one that everybody thought was the most dangerous. I said, you haven't seen anything until you see that coach deal.
That hurt you?
We could cheat and do it down here low and have Amherst actually drop him.
My participation in the Temple of Doom was greater than Raiders, I would say, because I was on it from prep right the way through. But again, it was planning and plotting and coming up with gags that were original and trying to find ways of doing them that were different, because we had everything in Raiders. Now we've got to start and do a whole movie. It wasn't just coming up with one sequence. Obviously, most of it was written, but there's, you know, it's fine-tuning and polishing that goes on.
I'd rather see a couple of blows on him that don't dent him and just leave me there wondering what to do next.
The first stunt, real stunt we did was coming out of the Obi-Wan Kenobi nightclub, crashing through the canopies and bouncing into the car. And we used a piece of equipment on that called a fan descender, which I'd invented a couple of years earlier, which controlled the descent of myself and Wendy, my wife, through the canopies. In fact, my wife, Wendy Leach, was the double for all the girls, Kate Capshaw and everybody, all through the Indiana Jones series.
Good. Thank you, Wendy. We didn't know that. Come over here, too.
I have waited 6 weeks for this.
This is my own sweat that I've been saving for weeks at home.
Well, the problem with doing, cliffhanging serials is that every time you do one, you have to try to do something bigger and better in the next one. So finally, when we got to the third film, Steven came up with this tank duel. There's a lot of different elements in that. It's a very long sequence, and each little piece of that sequence involves a lot of very intense stunt work that we had to pull off in order to make that whole thing work.
On The Last Crusade, as it was on the Temple of Doom, I came in with, you know, weeks of prep, and then we did all that tank chase, shot all the tank chase. And the tank wouldn't go more than about 10, 12 miles an hour, so everything's undercranked to make it go fast. But of course, you've got a galloping horse, so it was quite difficult to ride the horse and look as though you're going fast, but make him not go fast. Otherwise, you had two frames where, you know, he just pulled away from the tank too quickly. You know, the horse is doing about 25 miles an hour, not the tank doing 12.
Well, one of the things we did, Stephen liked Pat Roach, who is a big stunt guy, huge guy, and so we used him a couple of times, actually, in Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Pat Roach, he became a kind of tradition in the Indiana Jones movies to play multiple parts inside every picture.
His part in Last Crusade was sort of cut down quite a bit, but we used him in all three films. He was sort of a kind of a running gag in the films.
It'd be really funny if the horn came up right there.
Whenever I look back and I think of stunts, I think of the Indiana Jones movies before anything else. And I've had such good experiences working with stunt people, and Indy certainly has taken advantage of the best of that world.
We're not in this business for fame. Stuntmen, we're journeymen. We carry a bag, and I go from this show to that show to that show, do the best job you can, and hopefully every once in a while you get involved with a classic piece.
They really, really were enjoyable times, and everybody's still got great affection for each other, and I think we all feel we've been part of something really quite special in film history.
Great, but my heart stopped.